So good morning. Is this okay for the microphone? So first of all, thank you for introducing us so nicely and for all the laudatio you did on our consultation. This is an enormous impact for our work. If I listen to how it was used in Germany, I'm really pleased to learn this, because this is exactly what we were trying to do with the consultation, is to raise the awareness and to put it on the European agenda, not as a top-down exercise from Brussels, but as a distributed exercise. But I come back to that in a second. And allow me to say that I really think, dear colleague, that the Information Broker Society, used to be called the librarians of the past, have an enormous role to play in this topic. Because in the end, it is not only about technologies, it's also about making sense out of the explosion of availability of data, knowledge, and what you can do with it. So I do think that your constituency is enormously important there, and I really are convinced of that, but I come back to that in a second as well. So I'm thanks for inviting us. I will try to give you a condensed overview of why do we do it, what do we mean by it, I mean science too, what is our policy, what was the consultation, what are the key results, and what are the key consequences? Because the key results, most of them you can read on our website, I think you will also be interested to hear what we think are the policy consequences of this, and where we will take initiatives in very soon, actually, and are busy developing them. So the talk will be in three parts. So for us, Science 2.0, and it was already mentioned by Professor Tochterman before me, is that it is much more Science 2.0 than open access, open data, one element. We see Science 2.0 as a systemic change in the modus operandi, meaning how you do science and research. So it affects the whole research cycle, and it affects all the stakeholders. So it is not only about researchers, it's about funders, it's about publishers, it's about universities, it's about the whole ecosystem of science and research which we know, and it is much more than an isolated issue. And I think it's an important element, and that also makes it worth reflecting on it together, and also makes it a little bit more complicated than if you would only look at open access or citizen science, because then you take one element out of it and then you can contain it. But it is precisely because it all fits together that there is a challenge there. And that's why we started the work on it 2 years ago, 3 years ago. Actually, it was one of the last things I started in IPTS when I was still at the research side of the world. And that's why we think it is worth reflecting on it together. So the way we see it and what triggered our interest is, if the classical research cycle, and I'm of course simplifying here, is the green. You have your question, you gather your data. If you don't find the data, in the prehistory when I made my PhD, a lot of your PhDs were determined by the fact, can you find data or not? Well, if you don't find the data, which is not a problem anymore these days, there is data abundancy, then you go to the analysis, you do your publication 2 years after you finished your analysis, you get a review 3 years later, and then the cycle starts again. A little bit like that. Now, what is Science 2.0 about? Is that at all levels of the life cycle, so to speak, of doing research and science, you see new ways of doing things in a much more open and much more faster, much more distributed and much more networked way. And that's all the blue bubbles you see. I'm not going to go into the details, because you know them as for sure, but these are the blue things. You have open annotation, open data, open workflows, data-intensive science, data-driven science, citizen science, open code. I can also see it on my screen, sorry. Open code, preprint, open access, etc. So it's the whole system, the systemic change, that makes us think about what is going on, which is called open science. And when we really thought, as European policymakers, that we should start working on it, is when we looked at the white dots around the blue bubbles. These are all startups, public, private, NGO, public, not-for-profit, for-profit, etc., capitalizing on the new way of doing research and science. In other words, you see an ecosystem of services and standards and companies, non-companies, not-for-profit, emerging that are, in fact, an embodiment of the new reality of science and research. And that did us realize that this is a new challenge for Europe, eh? And in particular, that we did not want to miss that challenge as a European policymaker. So it is about a systemic change, it is real, it is happening today, and it is, in our view, irreversible. That, I think, is important to understand for policymakers across the globe, because, or at least in Europe, is that it is not only digital technologies who drive it, who make it, who enable it. It also has to do with the explosion of data. The Internet of Things, the Internet of Everything, will only increase data availability. As a result, much more possibilities for research, much more ways of doing new research, much more possibilities for tackling new research data. 2 days ago, the whole fuss around Apple launching the health kit is precisely, you use your telephone as a health tracker, your iPhone or whatever phone you have. It is actually a data point helping you to do new types of data for health research in a certain sense, but also for yourself. The so-called quantified self is an enormous amount of knowledge that is there lying that can be used for new ways of doing research, which was not possible before. It was impossible before to know exactly how many stairs you do, how many distance you do, how many this and how many that. So the data-drivenness is certainly as important as the ICT. It's also irreversible because it's part of the globalization of the science community. The science community is growing, not exponentially, but is growing continuously with 2-3% on an annual basis. And the forecasts are that in 20 to 25 years, we will be 3 times as much researchers globally as today, meaning much more people needing to do research, needing to publish, needing to have a career, etc. Hence, much more pressure on the publication system, on the science system, etc. There is also the pressure on the science system to be much faster with the grand challenges. If you look at what happened with the Ebola outbreak, immediately by putting the data in the open, there was an emergence of a network way of trying to capture and to understand how the Ebola pandemic emerged, how it was taken on board, etc. So it is something that we cannot no longer imagine to wait for until there is a final publication somewhere in a journal to come up with a remedy. So open up the science there allows you to address the grand challenges much faster. It also has to do with rising expectations for citizens, more responsiveness, more reliability, which is required from our science system. And it is one of your compatriots, Dr. Vogel, from the Naturwissenschaftliche Museum in Berlin, who says it over and over again in our workshops that, well, if we want 3% of the GDP to be allocated on science and innovation, we better make sure that we have a transparent policy on it so that people can see what is done with that public money. And there is some truth in there. And then finally, it is irreversible because the Facebook generation is becoming now a Facebook researcher generation. And that is also explaining why Mendeley, academia, EU, and so are skyrocketing in terms of membership, because I think Mendeley is 2-3 million now, academia over 5 million members, and that is something. Of course, it's almost an extension of the Facebook dynamics that you see now happening in the research world. So all these factors together make it quite irreversible. It's also, and that is, I think, very important not to forget, it's not happening in isolation. What we see happening in the science world is also happening in other parts of our society. The whole movement for open source software, Linux, the whole movement towards collaborative knowledge production, towards Creative Commons, 400,000 licenses were the last figures that I saw, towards open innovation, the whole new thing of the collaborative, the sharing economy, the BNB, the Uber, etc. Well, I know Uber is a tricky example, but you see what I mean. So all these things are not happening in an isolation. And actually, what is happening now in the science and research world is exactly what started 10 to 15 years ago in economy, in the social world, in manufacturing, in culture, in media, due to Web 2. What is happening there? What happened there is now slowly going into our field, in our remit. And the whole question, of course, is will it be as fundamental, as paradigmatic in a change as it was for economy. Take Amazon.com, how it changed the media or the cultural sector and the retail sector, etc. Will it be as deep a change as it will as it has been in those sectors? And if so, what is the consequences of that? So, we also think that it offers great opportunities. The Science 2.0 movement, better value for money, more transparency, more efficiency. Opening up the data allows you to do much more with the same availability of data. As being reproducible increases the efficiency of the system. I do know that there will also be much more fraud possible because of openness, but that you have to see in the context of a growing population of scientists as well. If the scientific population triples in the next 10 to 15 years, well, then probably the fraud will triple also in the next 10 to 15 years. So there is a little bit of a correlation there as well. So you see the point there. I don't think I have to go into the details. So that was our analysis. We made a paper on that. We tried to understand the shifts. It's all available on the website. I'll show you at the end. And then we said, in the end, we are a European policymaker. If we want to go on with this, we must know what Europe thinks, and in particular what its stakeholders, the whole range of stakeholders, thinks about it. So we started the consultation in July. Last year, to test, first of all, what is the awareness? Secondly, what are the opportunities, and are they shared by the stakeholders? And thirdly, what are potential policy implications? In French, they say it's a subjonctive. It is only if the problem is seen that we can think of a policy implication. It's not the other way around. It's very important to bear that in mind. So the consultation was drafted, we developed a set of questions, we launched it in July, we closed it in September, we got, given the holiday period, we got a very significant amount of responses, so 498 submitted responses, of which 164 organizations, so the Lerus of this world, the Eartos of this world, they gave one response, but actually behind them you have many more, if you quantify it, people hanging. So it is quite representative. We did not really check if it is fully representative, but it is quite representative for the stakeholders in Europe. And we also got on top of that, without asking for it, so close to 30 position papers of different organizations, and not the smallest one, the big stakeholder groupings, submitting their view on the subject and suggesting us what to do. So that was, from that point of view, I think it is a safe way to say that it was a good consultation in terms of responsiveness. Now, what are some of the main outcomes? First of all, because we had endless discussions inside the Commission, what is now the best term? Science 2, open science, open digital science, and at some point we said, you know what, we're going to ask it, so then it is over, that discussion. And there you see the majority, well, not the majority, but 43% of the respondents of those 500 opted for open science as the lead term to be used rather than Science 2.0. So from now on, we speak about open science. And by the way, behind that slide, you also will see that I lost a few bottles of champagne because Science 2 was my idea too. And I did a few bets on it, but I lost it, so it is open science now. And in a certain sense, if you go back to what I said a while ago about open innovation, there is a match there. You can because that one of the things we are developing now is the links between open science and open innovation. So there is a match to be made there. But okay, it's open science. So, what do people then see? How do they judge our analysis of Science 2/Open Science? So it was really comforting for us to see that an overwhelming majority of the respondents did subscribe more or less to our analysis, meaning the trends are perceived as pertinent, the consequences are perceived as pertinent, but also the uncertainties, because in our paper we also listed a few uncertainties and not the least there. So that was, broadly speaking, a significant amount, a very significant amount of our stakeholders in Europe at all levels of the research cycle support the paper. What are then, by the stakeholders, perceived as the key drivers of Science 2.0. So if you remember my slide of a while ago, 6-7 key drivers, so we asked that explicitly. Do you see that as a key driver for changing the landscape or not? And if so, to what degree do you agree with it? So if you count the green and the blue, because the green is yes, full stop, the blue is yes, but. So actually you can count it together. You see that most of our drivers, so the enabling by ICT, the data-drivenness, researchers looking for new opportunities to publish their work and to get some output validated in their career, the growth of the scientific population, you all find to a very significant amount until the penultimate driver, which is scientific publishers engaging in science 2.0, you still have more than 60% yes, yes, but. So that means that among stakeholders, it is perceived that there is indeed something going on which is deeper than only one element of the chain changing. I draw your attention to one remarkable, which we did not expect, result is that the last driver, namely citizens acting as scientists, citizen science, to say it in a different way, is perceived as the least important driver and lower than 50%, close to 40, if you combine the two, of all of them. So that we did not expect, so to speak. The rest we did more or less expect, but not overwhelmingly so. Now, of course, there is an explanation for that. This was not sent to citizens. This was sent to researchers, to universities, to funders. So there is a bit of a distortion there in the people who responded. But still, you can deduce from that the whole movement of citizen science is not perceived to be as important by the stakeholders as we tend to see, which doesn't mean it's not important. That's a different discussion. But that is something to keep in mind. Secondly, what are the barriers of developing open science for at the level of the individual scientist? Well, interestingly enough, the main barrier in terms of do you see the trend developing? Do you see yourself being engaged in it? Is of course the concern about quality assessment. Again, quality assurance. Sorry. Again, take the green and the blue together. It's close to 90%. So. It shows you that actually the main concern of our researchers themselves and the people around them is, will the system be as good as the present system? That's actually what it says. Secondly, very closely, not very important, I think, for a policymaker, for policymaking in general, is that the main barrier by scientists, for the scientists, is seen of the lack of incentives. And that is, of course, that is the discussion. I'm willing to share my data. I'm willing to go for open data, but not myself. Yeah, you know that kind of boutade. Oh yes, of course, I go for openness, but not mine, because that's my competitive advantage. I know my data, and no one else has them. It's a little bit that. So, what is the incentive for a scientist to engage in the whole open science movement? And if we want this to develop. And I think we have no other choice, given the global trends in there. That means our incentive system at every level, funder, universities, etc., has to follow. Thirdly, very important, is the lack of existing infrastructures to cope with the developments. And that's the whole debate about data-driven science and where to host, make accessible, and at what cost the explosion of data in every different field. So that was for us something important. It also came back in the validation workshops, but I will come back to that in a second. And the rest you can read there, but it's all more or less, the rest is more or less logical, to be expected, so to speak, at the lack of financial support. Uncertain benefits, that goes together with the incentives, of course. Legal constraints, the whole discussion about text and data mining and copyright comes there. I draw your attention, this is close to 80%, seen as 80% of the responses are saying this is a very important barrier for the development of open science. And then again, what we did not expect, but the same disclaimer applies as with regard to citizen science, is that the least important barrier, but it still is 70%, is concerns about ethical and privacy issues. Again, same disclaimer, and do not forget, it is still 70% there. So it is not trivial, but it is not the most important. Whereas for a policymaker, for example, you start from the opposite. You would say this is the most important thing or the most important barrier. Now, then there were a series of questions on what is the impact of open science for our economy and for the research system. I would say no big surprises there except one. First of all, it will make science much more reliable. We all know that most of the high impact published papers are not reproducible because the data are not accessible. So if you make them accessible, you make it replicable and you get better science. You might get better science, let me put it this way. So that is self-evident. An overwhelming amount of responses go in that direction. That's really encouraging. I really think that's my personal view. As we're working with public money, so the more we can do to improve the quality and the transparency and the reliability of our work, of your work, the better. So it is a strong incentive, I think, for thinking about it in terms of policy making. So more reliable, more efficient, getting faster and wider innovation. Remember what I said about Ebola, they were quite quick in determining the history of the virus in Africa due to openness of the data and the collaborative effort of the science community. So it applies to other things as well, etc. The least perceived effect it would have on our economy and the research system is that, and that is, I think, interesting for the policy debates, is of course that crowdsourcing is not seen as a very important, crowdsourcing for research, sorry, is not seen as one of the most important effects as a result of open science. Again, this is something that in a you would tend to think intuitively, just like privacy and like citizen science, to be much more important. But again, same disclaimer, look at who responded here, and you will understand why it scores relatively low. Again, it's more than 50%. Don't forget that. Okay, then the question, on what issues do you see policy desirable? Desirable is not the same as needed. Is there a desirable cluster of fields, of clusters of actions policymakers should consider given the development towards open science? So what you see there is of course the average responses, and the top area where our respondents said policy should go on is not a surprise, because these are already the areas very well developed. So everything that has to do with openness, open access for publications, first cluster, open access for data, second one. Do something about the research infrastructures. Remember, it was seen as the third barrier with regard to the development of open science. In a certain sense, the fact that we should do more about openness and for access and publications links to the concern, what are the incentives to do it? So it is a perfect mirror, not a perfect mirror, it is a mirror of actually the concerns with regard to the barriers. Then the fourth area is the assessment of the quality of research. Remember, the biggest concern expressed was, will the system be as good as, produce as good science as the Science 1.0 system, so to speak. Alternative reputation systems. That goes together, of course, with the incentives. If I really go into much more open science type of work as a researcher, will that be discounted, or will it be counted in my career development? Will it be part of my curriculum? If I start blogging, and my blogging is enormously popular in the scientific community, will that also be counted as a high-impact publication, to put it bluntly? That is actually what it is all about. So, and there I think this is a very important area for the future as well, text and data mining and so on. So these are the key areas as came out of the consultation. Except for one, citizen science, you can say that there is broad support for most of the areas. Most of them are clustered around infrastructures, incentives, and embedding. And that made us start thinking about what we can do with that in terms of of the future. So what we did then do after the consultation is once we had all the data, we organized 4 validation workshops, bringing together all the stakeholders in Europe, across Europe actually, and I see actually some of the participants sitting in the room now. So we organized 4 validation workshops around the 4 big group of stakeholders, funders, academies, universities, etc., that are important in our field. So we presented them the data in a bit more elaborate way as here, and then we tried in a full day to make sense out of this together with them. What does it mean now for policy? In parallel, we have presented this story and all the things around it at least 30 times across Europe to academies, to learned societies, to what have you. So I think it is fair to say that around, besides the 500 people who replied to consultation, we talked or we implied around 500 people in an interactive discussion on the topic. A little bit like today, but not that big, I must say. So it all in all, that would be I think a fair evaluation of the amount of people involved. So we did all these things, we did all these validation workshops, and then we came up with a synthesis, which is also published and which some of you have used in your own mapping of the consultation. And as a result of that, we see 3 areas for possible future policy. First of all, initiatives around big data infrastructures, quite logical. Not quite logical, quite understandable, given data-driven science, given the cost, given the hosting, etc. You have also to see under there the whole issue of open access and open data. Secondly, improving the framework conditions. That goes together with the incentives and the barriers. Try to get away from the barriers to foster open science. And then thirdly, it is written there as making it more efficient. It's actually meaning embedding it also in the reality of the scientific of science today. And you mentioned it previously that you are also thinking in Germany of how to translate it now into the work programs. So that is, for example, something that was understood under the third bullet. So these are the 3 big areas for potential policy action. At every level, so we also try to map out who should do what at what level. I can go into the details later on if you want, but actually it boils down to those 3. Extremely important for me, for us in Brussels, is that regardless of the stakeholder, regardless of the area where we should be active, what came back over and over and over again, and I think it's a very important lesson/instruction for us, is that whatever you do in this area, it has to be bottom-up and it has to be stakeholder-driven. In other words, don't do it top-down and don't make it Brussels decide. It's as simple as that, or whoever decides. And that is, I think, quite logical. The science community is largely self-steering. It's largely the whole mechanism about the whole peer review mechanism is a self-steering mechanism, if you want. And it is also an emanation of this attitude. But it means it's very important, because if you then think about if we should do something on infrastructure or on framework conditions, you can only do it if you have all the stakeholders on board and if it is a bottom-up process, meaning you can only do whatever what is already there, otherwise it will probably not work. So that are the important lessons for us. So where we are, and then that's where we are today. So we have now these insights. We have the clear framework or the clear setting what we can do, and bottom-up stakeholder-driven. Policy-wise, what we are doing today is we are developing the whole open science agenda in the Digital Single Market Initiative of the Juncker Commission. As you know, the Juncker Commission has 10 priorities. The second one is the Digital Single Market. We are hooking our work there together with the colleagues from Connect into that. That Digital Single Market Initiative will be adopted somewhere in May, and we are confident that we will be prominently present in there. Secondly, we have the Latvian presidency. So as you probably know, the Latvians are now chairing the council. So until June, they have taken up the whole issue of digital / open science quite high on their agenda. So we had a discussion at the Competitiveness Council in March and another one in May on these results. And that means actually at member state level. So that's really, really very important, because you see there that the topic is really living in the member states. It is not a northern, southern, center topic only. Every member state is aware of it, and it's a little bit what you said also that happened, what is happening now, which happened last year in Germany. And then our key action will of course be that when we have our big conference 22-23 June in Brussels, which is called, which is a conference on opening up the era or innovating era. The first day will be on open science as a new way of looking at era. And we hope to launch there a European open science action agenda with our commissioner, which then in a certain sense would mean this is from now on the policy we will develop. So that is where we are today. What will we do in that open science agenda? And then that closes. A few slides to close my presentation. But from now on, what I'm saying is under construction. This is something not representing what has already been decided. But it is where we are working on, where we think we have a common playing ground, where we think we will get support. But it is too early to say this is the position of the Commission. So please bear that in mind if you would like to quote this. This is not already decided, but it is under discussion at the highest level. So what we would like to put in that European Open Science agenda in June is, with regard to, remember, the three actions, the second one, fostering open science, we want to do something on creating a stakeholder forum, bottom-up, or a clearing type of mechanism, stakeholder-driven, so that we can have a forum in Europe, pan-European, across all stakeholders, to discuss all critical issues with regard to open science. I do not think that it is wise that every country comes by himself up with a solution. There are, by definition, science and research is doesn't stop at the boundaries. So the problems, the issues, the challenges, the opportunities don't stop there either. So that is the first thing what we would like to do. And then secondly, we would like to propose to work together with the stakeholders in such a stakeholder forum or however, whatsoever we would like to call it, for a European code of conduct with regard to open science, setting out the general principles and requirements of how it can affect the roles, the incentives, the responsibilities, and so on. That's one thing we are working on today. Secondly, under discussion is to mainstream. Remember, the policy actions asked for is do much more on open access for publications and for data. Well, one of the things we will certainly develop is to mainstream open access and data and open data policies across Horizon 2020 and the programs of the European Commission. Try to bring it to the member states. It is already bottom-up mushrooming everywhere, but still try to come to European level playing field. And then, much more important and less easy is, of course, to address guidelines where we to develop the guidelines to address the IPR issues of open data management. And that, as you know, the copyright text and data mining discussions is less easy to do. But still, this is on the agenda. This is clearly a result of the consultation, so we should take it serious. Thirdly, thirdly or second, depends on how you look at it. So with regard to the infrastructure level, so it is clear that there is a big need across stakeholders in Europe to do something about the data infrastructures needed for open science. And that's where we launched the idea, and we already discussed it in the Competitiveness Council, of developing a European research cloud. Now, don't see the cloud as a huge database somewhere in the basements of Brussels where someone is deciding on it. This we see as a, remember, stakeholder-driven bottom-up. It is a distributed approach. It is trying to do it bottom-up. It's a long discussion, which I don't have time to go into the details, but very quickly to show you the complexity of it and to what we're trying to do there is the research cloud is, of course, it's a concept where you look at what is already existing, let me go a bit quicker there, with regard to hosting infrastructures for disciplines. And the table we made there is that those disciplines who use, who are most advanced are on the left-hand side with regard to the hosting, and those who are least, and the access, etc., who are least advanced are on the right-hand side. There's no, I'm sure for you this is not a surprise. We all know that in physics, open data is a standard for already a long time. In humanities, it is only starting. Well, that figure gives you the distribution of it, and you also see the already existing initiatives. What you also see is there is no cross-linking between there. There is no cross-cutting between there, and it is not foreseen to come up with how will it respond to the explosion of data of the future. So the idea of a cloud then is to harmonize not the infrastructures, but to harmonize the interoperability between the infrastructures at the data layer, to harmonize it at the level of the services, because now it is mainly at the data layer, it is not at the at the services. If you don't harmonize the services, you cannot link physical data with let's say, applied with economics, just saying something. And as we know, all grand challenges are cost-cutting, so this is absolutely something to be needed at the long term. And to harmonize it also at the governance layer, or to come up with a governance layer that overlooks the whole system. So that's a bit of the way we are thinking of. So the cloud is not a centralized database in Brussels. The cloud is a distributed virtual infrastructure, virtual service layer, virtual governance layer that tries to make sure that the science community needs with regard to access, use, and hosting of data is taken care of in a way that can cope with the demands of the future. So we also hope that by doing this we can address the issues on privacy, IPR and TDM, because this makes a dedicated space in the whole cloud development. Again, this is what we are thinking of. This is not decided. This is not endorsed by anyone, but this is the pieces we are thinking of. And actually, this is the first time I presented outside the commission, so I'm really curious to hear what your reactions are on that. And these are, well, you see the existing initiatives, where they are positioned. So that's the big idea at the infrastructure level. Sorry. So this is my last slide. Then finally, remember, infrastructures, hosting, fostering, and then the third thing, embedding it in society. What we are trying to do now is increasingly so, but and I heard you do the same in Germany, is to make it, to embed open science, real open science in action, as we call it, in the work programs, meaning that it becomes a kind of a precondition. That's probably not the right word to say, but that we stimulate it via the funding which we are competent, which is Horizon 2020, and then of course via all the mechanisms we try to distribute the message to the member states. So that is in a nutshell where we are today. So we are taking the outcomes of the consultation into policy action. They reflect to a large degree what the main stakeholders, meaning you, told us. We do think there that, given all the discussions we have, that we have a level playing field for doing it. We do know that we must absolutely abide the bottom-up and stakeholder-drivenness. I think it's a very fair and very normal precondition. But of course, now the real thing starts, and my last slide is a call for action that we really should do it together. And it's a huge thing. It is quite fundamental. It's complex, and as you know, that everyone has his own opinion on it. So it's not so easy to get an unisono view there. So all the material you have seen is on this website, and I invite you, please, to whatever you can contribute, want to contribute, contact us or whatever you would like to do, it's more than welcome. And looking forward to that.
Okay, thank you very much. I think there's time for questions. Do you have questions to Jean-Claude Burgelmann from the Commission? There is one.
Good morning. Good morning, Jean-Claude. Thank you very much for this excellent presentation on the outcomes of Science 2.0. We had the pleasure to welcome you in the Research Policy Working Group of the European University Association a month ago. I didn't see all the outcomes that you have presented today, and I have actually two questions or comments. Let's see what your reaction would be. One is, in our response to this consultation, we address many of the issues that you have highlighted, and we are very happy that these are being taken up, particularly the dialogue with stakeholders. We are all for dialogue with stakeholders, so that is very important. I also welcome very much this open science platform that you are willing to create. My question is, we made a point that in addition to all these challenges that we highlighted, there's new profiles needed, new people with new skills. And I don't see that have been at least taken up in your presentation or in the plans to develop the open science platform. We from the universities think that this is essential because we will need technicians, we will need people with computational skills to deal with large data sets, also with interdisciplinary backgrounds, because they will probably have to be able to manage data from different disciplines precisely to foster this interdisciplinary aspect. So can you please elaborate on that?
Okay, so thanks for your for comment. Just to say it again, the dialogue with stakeholders, it's a bit more, it's co-creation. It must be co-creation or it will not work. I mean, I spent my 25 years at university, so I know a little bit how it works, and it will not, that's really important. Now, your point is of course very pertinent. It's as I told you when we met, I mean, I personally think that in 15 years' time we will have data professors, we have visualization researchers, we will people who will, my personal prediction is that we will have people making a career without publishing an article because there will be specialists in something that is related to it because of open data and so on, which means two things. We need new skills, and as we discussed together, I think that data management and visualization should become a standard course in universities, just as statistics or writing good English is today, so to speak. And I think it's quite, in my view, it's quite normal. And secondly, so that's the skills issue. Secondly, the incentive system of universities has to change also to make that possible. And that came back a lot of when researchers asked our questionnaires. We are more than willing to go for open science, but if my data activities are not taken into account, why should I do it? And it is interesting to see that there are initiatives developing to do that. Yeah, you get journals on data management, on data depositing. You get journals now on peer reviewing, where you are rated according to the number of peer reviews you do. So all that is changing, but that doesn't answer your question. So, because your question is, why don't you take it on board? And that is, of course, because we don't have the mandate to do it. We can, in our code of conduct, which we are working on, that's the maximum we can do to put the issues on the table. But all the rest is subsidiarity. And all the rest has to be via the member states, quite rightly so. So we will, of course, follow it up as much as we can do that. But as commission, there is not much that you can really do except recommendations.
Okay, thank you. Is there there's another question?
Hi, good morning. My name is Lindsay McKenzie. I'm a reporter for Research Europe magazine. I wanted to ask, you kind of alluded to the fact that open science may become a precondition of EU funding. How likely do you think that is, and what barriers do you foresee to making that a reality if that's what you intend? Thank you.
This is being filmed, eh? So, no, serious. I think I think it will be a reality, I think, so please, I think, not the Commission, I think it will be a reality before the end of the framework program. Maybe not as much as we would like to see it, so me and my fellow obsessionists on Science 2.0 in my unit, but it certainly is so that the spirits are ripe for it. We already proposed several things in the work programs, in the review of the work programs, and at least that's what we will try to do, that for the third strategic programming, so that starts in 3 years, there will be a significant amount of that in the work programs. This being said, it is already de facto happening. For example, if you look at the research programs in environment, there are big projects there on using distributed sensoring, distributed processing, called it citizen science, as one of the elements to monitor better environmental issues. So it is de facto happening, but where we would like to get is one step further, and that I think will happen before the end of the Horizon 2020. And I can tell you, and if you read the speeches of our commissioner, he's fully behind it. And maybe not nominatum for what I'm saying, but certainly to promote open science and to make it a reality. And quite frankly, so if we preach this, we should only develop it in our own thing.